Hello, everybody. It is my pleasure to welcome you at the first session of HCAR, which is the session 2A on superposition and saturation-based theorem proving. And the first talk is going to be a recorded talk by Jakob Rath, and the title is Subsumption Demodulation and First-Order Theorem Proving. It is joint work with Bernhard Gleiss and Laura Kovac, and I'm just starting the video.
Hello and welcome to my talk on subsumption demodulation in first-order theorem proving. This was joint work with Bernhard Gleiss and Laura Kovac. The motivation for this work came from Bernhard's PhD work on software verification using first-order theorem proving, in particular superposition-based theorem provers. As you probably all know, superposition is a sound and complete calculus for first-order logic with equality. In this setting, one major use of equality is the encoding of assignment semantics, and as long as we mostly have unit equalities, everything works quite well. But as soon as we have conditional equalities, that is, non-unit clauses with at least one equality literal, then there are some problems. And let's look at an example. Consider the following Hoare triple, where we have f of I equal to g of I in the precondition, then some statements you don't care about, and then an if statement with an assertion inside. And assume we want to prove that this assertion is never violated. So we can transform this into logical formulas and we might end up with something like this. So the precondition is a unit equality. And the if statement gets transformed into an implication where we have the condition on the left hand side and the semantics of the assertion on the right hand side. So we don't actually care about this exact predicate, so we can abstract it away. And let's focus on these two formulas. And then we pass these two formulas to a theorem prover. And the first step is usually to clausify them. So we end up with these two clauses. First, the unit clause with inequality, and second, this clause. And notice that we have here the term f of I. And now we can use a rule called demodulation to use this equality to rewrite f of I into g of I. And what is more, demodulation tells us that we can then delete this clause because it has become redundant. And now let's look at the slightly modified example where we have the same condition on the equality. So this might happen either if we change the precondition or if some assignment is in the same if statement, then we get the same condition on both of the implications. Now when we clausify them, we do not have a unit equality anymore, and demodulation can only apply with unit equalities. So now we cannot as easily derive the same clause as before. It is still possible to derive the same clause as before using the superposition rules, but now we have to use generating inference rules, which means that on the one hand, we won't discover that this clause becomes redundant. And on the other hand, it might take much longer to arrive at the other clause. So here we are dealing with saturation-based theorem proving. And now let's have a short overview over the saturation procedure. So here, each of these three dots represents one clause that is known to the prover. And our goal is usually to derive the empty clause, because that means we have found a contradiction. Now we can apply inferences to derive new clauses. And we call inferences like these generating inferences because they add new clauses to the space. Now in theory, since superposition is sound and complete, this should allow us to prove everything that should be able to be proved. But in practice, if we use this naive saturation procedure as it is, then we quickly run into problems because there are way too many inferences and the search space blows up. So we just run out of resources, either time or memory. Now there are several refinements to improve the situation, like orderings, redundancy, and selection. And let me just talk a bit about redundancy. Sometimes when we perform an inference, we discover that one of the premises becomes redundant. That just means we can delete it from the space without losing any relevant consequences. And we call inferences like these simplifying inferences, because the new clause is in some sense simpler than the one that has been replaced. So note that after the simplifying inference, the set of clauses known to the prover is still the same size. Now, before we can formally define redundancy, we need to talk a bit about orderings. And so we can start with any simplification ordering as term ordering. And that is just a partial ordering that satisfies these three conditions. First, monotonicity. If you replace a term inside another term with a smaller one, then the whole term gets smaller. Then it should be stable under substitutions. So if a term is larger than another one, and if you apply substitution, we keep the ordering relation. And finally, the subterm property. Any term is larger than all of its subterms. And then when we have such a term ordering, we can extend it to the clause ordering using the multiset extensions. And here we also require that equality literals are smaller than all other literals. Now let's look a bit closer at redundancy. When a clause is redundant, that means we can remove it from the space without losing any relevant consequences. A ground clause is redundant in a set of ground clauses if it is the logical consequence of smaller clauses. So there are C1 to Cn in the space, such that they imply C, and all of those Ci's are smaller than C in the clause ordering. For non-ground clauses, we have to consider that a non-ground clause is an abbreviation for all of its ground instances. So a non-ground clause represents all of its ground instances. And so we can say a non-ground clause is redundant in a set of clauses if all of its ground instances are redundant with respect to some ground instances of clauses in S. So for each ground instance of C, we have the above ground redundancy with respect to some ground instances of clauses in S. Okay, we have seen demodulation in the example before. Now let's look at it in a bit more detail. So we have two premises. One is a unit equality, S equal to T. And the second one somewhere has a term S theta, an instance of S. And this S theta will be rewritten to T theta. But like it is given now, this rule is not a simplification rule. For that, we need two extra conditions. So first of all, obviously S theta must be larger than T theta. And second, we also need that the right premise is larger than the instance of the left premise. Now let's look at a small example again. The left premise is fx equal to x. Right premise fc equal to gd, and we want to rewrite fc to c. Here the first side condition holds because of the subterm property of the term ordering, but we also need to check the second side condition. So we have to compare these two clauses, and we can see the left term is equal, and on the right side the gd is larger than c, so by the properties of the multiset extension, we have that the left literal is larger than the right literal. So the side condition holds and we really have a simplification here. So now we want to generalize demodulation to non-unit equalities. So compared to demodulation, in the left premise we add some literal C, and in the right premise we add the instance of those literals, C theta. And the effect of the rule is again rewriting of S theta to T theta. And again we need some side conditions. The first is unchanged, S theta must be larger than T theta. And the second one is again the right premise must be larger than the instance of the left premise. We call this rule subsumption demodulation because we can use techniques from subsumption checking to implement the rule. Now using these two side conditions, we can prove that subsumption demodulation is sound and it is a simplification rule. Now there's two issues that need to be solved before we can implement this rule. First, we need to decide how to find this C and C theta, because a priori we just get a clause and we don't have it neatly split up like this into L, C theta and D. And second, how do we check the second side condition? So let's look at the first problem. Subsumption is an important rule in first order theorem proving. And it works like this. When you have two clauses C and D, and an instance of C is a submultiset of D, then D is redundant and subsumption deletes D. And virtually all first order theorem provers need a highly optimized algorithm for subsumption because it's so important for solver performance. So the idea here is to reuse this algorithm for finding C and C theta. Now for the second issue of checking the second side condition, we have the following lemma from properties of the multiset extension. So because the clause ordering is a multiset extension, we can cancel this C theta on both sides and we arrive at the same check as for demodulation. So this we can reuse as well. Now we have implemented both the forward and the backward direction of subsumption demodulation in Vampire. And I didn't explain what forward and backward means. For simplification rules, the forward direction is the one where you have a newly derived clause and you simplify this clause using knowledge from previously derived clauses. And the backward direction is the other one where you derive some new clause and use the knowledge from this clause to simplify all the existing ones in the storage. Okay, so the main challenges in our implementation were that we needed to do some improvements to the multiliteral matching in Vampire, and second, that we had to add a new clause index. Let me just talk a bit about the multiliteral matching here. So the multiliteral matching, given in clauses C and D, tries to find a substitution theta such that C theta is a submultiset of D. So this is the expensive part of the subsumption check. And in Vampire, this is a highly optimized component. So we adapted this component for subsumption demodulation. Okay, to illustrate how this works in the regular subsumption case, here's a small example. So the above clause is C, and the below clause is D, and we try to find a substitution theta such that the instance of C is a submultiset of D. So in the third step, we do a cheap pre-filtering. For example, a p-literal can only be matched to p-literals, and that's quite easy to discover. And in the next step, we do a backtracking search. So in the first step, we match px to this literal, and here you can see the partial substitution. Then in the second step, we discover that the second literal cannot be matched to anything because the partial substitution isn't compatible with x maps to c. So we backtrack, choose the other choice for px, and then we can also match this literal to this one. And here we have found a match. So this means that the clause below is redundant and we can delete it. Now for subsumption demodulation, note that if the side premise contains more than one equality literal, we don't a priori know which one we want to use for rewriting. So here the idea was to interleave this equality selection with the literal matching. So let's look at an example again. So the clause above is the side premise, and the clause below is the main premise, which should be simplified. And again in the third step we do some pre-filtering. And in the backtracking search we first match this px to pc. In the second step, we might want to match this equality literal to this equality literal. Then in the third step, we discover that we cannot match this q to any other literal because this y is already mapped to d in the partial substitution. And since we are looking for an instantiation and not the unification, we cannot match it with this literal. So here we have to backtrack. And now since we are doing subsumption demodulation, we can now choose this equality literal for rewriting. And now in the last step, we can match this q to this q, since now y was not bound. So now we have a match, and we can use the equality to rewrite this term into the smaller one, and we have simplified the second premise. So then we did some experiments to evaluate our new implementation, and we compared four different vampire configurations, first with and without forward subsumption demodulation, short FSD, and two with and without backward subsumption demodulation, short BSD. So that gives us four combinations. And for the options we used the portfolio mode of vampire. So the portfolio mode is the mode where vampire tries lots of different strategies in succession. And if you want to prove some problem, then generally you would use this portfolio mode. We have used a timeout of 5 minutes, and FSD and BSD have been enabled in all strategies. Now there's a caveat, and the portfolio mode is optimized for the existing options without FSD and BSD. So the resulting strategies here will be suboptimal, but the advantage is that it allows us to evaluate FSD and BSD with a lot of different strategies. So we have run the experiment on the StarExec cluster using the following problems. From the TPTP version 7.3.0, we chose 14,000 problems. That's all the problems with equality and that Vampire can pass. And from SMTlib, we chose the problems with linear arithmetic, uninterpreted functions, and data types. And again, only those where equality appears. Now for the results in TPTP. So here we have a solver comparison plot where each of the dots represents one problem. And on the x-axis, we have how long Vampire took to solve the problem without FSD and BSD. And on the y-axis, we have how long it took with FSD and BSD both enabled. So what we are interested here are these green dots on the right side, because those are the problems that Vampire was able to solve with FSD and BSD, but not without them. Now let's look at the actual numbers. If you look at the total number of solved problems, we can see that we unfortunately lost some. However, this is somewhat expected because we enabled the new options in all the strategies. And that means some strategies and problems simply don't benefit from the new options. But we can also see that there are problems that benefit much from FSD and BSD. For example, when we enable both of them, we can solve 30 new problems that the regular portfolio mode was unable to solve. And now looking at the results for SMTlib, they are actually quite similar, so I won't go into much detail here. Just that we have here 76 problems that the regular mode couldn't solve. Then we were interested to see how other solvers perform on these problems. So we took the 30 from TPTP and 76 from SMTlib that Vampire with FSD and BSD enabled was able to solve over the regular portfolio mode. So we can see that in TPTP, there remain 11 that were only solved by Vampire with FSD and BSD. And in SMTlib, we can see that the combination of CVC4 and Z3 were able to solve all of them, but none of them were able to solve all 76 by themselves. Of course, there's a lot that can be done as future work. So first we would like to make the multilateral matching and the selection of the rewriting equality more intelligent by adapting some ideas from SMT solving. Secondly, Vampire has an implementation of set-to-clause subsumption using code trees. They are currently unused, but it would be very interesting to restore them and see how we can adapt them to subsumption demodulation. And third, we want to do all three of subsumption, subsumption demodulation, and subsumption resolution together at the same time. But this is quite tricky. One problem here is that if we are not careful, we can perform several subsumption demodulation steps on a clause pair before finally discovering that we actually have subsumption and we should have deleted the clause all along. And also it would be nice if we could train the portfolio mode to take subsumption demodulation into account. Okay, so we have seen subsumption demodulation as a generalization of demodulation to conditional equalities. And we have seen that it is a simplification rule for superposition-based provers. And you can find the code online at this link, Actually, now it's already merged in the master branch, so you can just download the most recent vampire code. So that's it. Thanks for listening.
Thank you. Thank you, Jakob, for a very nice talk. We now move into the Q&A part. Are there any questions? So let me remind everybody that there are several ways of asking questions. You can either type them into the Q&A box, or you can raise your hand if you are an attendee, or if you have been already promoted to a panelist because you are a co-author of some other papers that are gonna happen in this session, you can just unmute yourself and ask directly. Hopefully there is not going to be too much shouting. I don't see any question just yet, so let me ask one. Jakob, are you there to answer?
Yes, I'm sorry.
Great. There are also questions coming through the Q&A. Let me start with those then. I'll ask with the first one from Kuhn Klassen. He's interested in knowing what is the SMT-inspired method for improvements you are considering for future work.
Right, so that's mostly concerned with the multilateral matching we have seen. So currently the implementation is straightforward. So we would like to also we'd also like to do clause learning in this implementation. And why did I say SMT? Because then we can consider the compatibility of the substitutions like a simple theory. So
I'm seeing that Giles asked the same question. And let me now read one from Hans. He's saying, if I remember correctly, in most cases, the site literals are type literals. That means if you're using a simply setting, subsumption demodulation becomes less important. Simply typed setting, I'm assuming. Is that right?
I think he can't answer because he's not a panelist.
Sorry?
I thought you asked a clarification on the question because
No. This is I'm just reading the reading the question. So the question is about
Yes, I'm not actually sure about that.
The type literals being often the site literals for subsumption demodulation. And
I'm not quite sure about what you mean with type literals.
The way I'm understanding it is that sometimes you use predicates literals as type guards if you are in the simply typed setting. But then I'm a little bit confused by the question as well, because I would say that means that if you are in an untyped first order logic, then you would probably see more of these type guards if people were trying to encode multi-sorted logic in the unsorted language. Yes, now I can allow Hans to talk. Hopefully this is working. Hans, you can unmute and ask yourself and clarify, please.
Do you hear me?
Now it's better. Yes. Sorry, I had to unmute you as well.
Okay. So my question is, so when I remember that I tried this rule that the site literals, they are type atoms, literals of the form X is a natural or Y is a real number or whatever. Okay. And if you have a theorem prover that has a simple types built in, then you don't have these type literals anymore because they are checked by the type system. And then this rule becomes mm-hmm. less important. Do you think that this is true? Does this apply in your case?
I think in our translation from the in the motivation. Most of the side literals come from statements that are together in the same guarded block, like in the same while statement or in the same if statement. So those will then be translated into implications, and they all have the same left-hand side. So in this case, it would still be relevant.
Okay. Okay, so thanks.
Yeah.
I don't see any other questions at the moment, but I also wanted to ask one. So when I was doing my PhD in Cybricken, there was some development inside SPAS, which was probably going back to some theory already worked out by Bachmann Gansinger, which, and I remember, if I'm recollected, the rule was called contextual rewriting. Is subsumption demodulation somehow related to it?
Yes, so actually subsumption demodulation is an instance of contextual rewriting, except that the side conditions are easier to check. For example, in contextual rewriting, you don't require that the side literals are contained in the main premise, but you somehow prove it from the main premise. You need to recursively prove some implications to justify the rule application. And that is much more expensive.
I see. I'm assuming that there was some kind of lightweight version of proving when this was becoming a practical inference rule in SPAS, but probably still more heavyweight than
yes,
your subterm
demodulation,
right?
I think that's the one called subterm contextual rewriting.
Okay.
So there they do not prove all possible implications, but a restricted subset that is easier to check. But still, you have to recursively call the whole rewriting mechanism of SPAS.
Uh-huh.
So it's still more expensive.
Okay, now I guess that some kind of performance comparison wasn't done, but do you have an idea whether when you were running SPAS on the problems uniquely solved by Vampire with subsumption demodulation, it might have been using the subterm contextual rewriting?
Yes, actually, that was the second experiment where we tried SPAS also with contextual rewriting enabled.
Uh-huh.
Because it's not enabled by default, so.
Okay, so it was actually part of the result table.
Right, so it was able to solve some problems, but not all of them.
Mm-hmm. I think we have time for one more question. We have like 1 minute before we need to switch to the next talk. Since there are no other questions, I'll thank you, Jakub, one more time. Thank you for a very interesting talk. And